I want to say thank you. For the past couple of years have been very interesting, as many of you know. And I've been dependent on the Lord's grace and the prayers and faithfulness of God's people. You all know what's happened, or many of you anyway. And so I want you to be encouraged by prayer, because that's been answered, in my case, many times. Many people were praying from the west coast of America to New Zealand with John and Nikki, and people in between. And so people have been amazed. In fact, yesterday I talked to a friend I hadn't seen for five, 6 years, or perhaps more, many years, and was recounting my illness and the healing and giving glory to God. And he's not a man of faith, so you never know where it will go. His wife is pleased. So thank you again for your prayers. They are fruitful. When you begin praying and you wonder whether God is answering prayer, well, just remember that God does answer prayer. And so, to give you a heads up on what's happening, I've got a devotional for a few minutes, and you know I'm not really famed for brevity, am I, Frank? So, short devotion, then we're going to pray, we're going to have a hymn. I can't remember it now, but there it is, we're going to have it. And Tony will come up and preach immediately after that. The Bereans. I wanted to consider the Bereans for a few minutes this morning. We find them in Acts chapter 17. We read this, and if you have a Bible and want to turn to it, you can do, but I'll read it anyway. Now these Jews were more noble than those in Thessalonica. They received the word with all eagerness, examining the scriptures daily to see if these things were so. Many of them, therefore, believed, and not a few Greek and women of high standing, as well as men. Berea, where is it? What do you know about the Bereans? Some of you have been to Greece on holiday, and some of you have a mental idea of Greece. Well, it's up the north side. It's on the Greek side of the bridge from Asia to Europe. And when Paul came across, he came to Thessalonica and a few other places. The Thessalonians, Jews, were not particularly helpful, not particularly friendly. So the brothers in Thessalonica got Paul and Silas to go out of the city. And they went to this place called Berea, which is about 50 miles southwest. And it's called Berea today, so the B has changed to a V, but apart from that, it's the same place. So let's have a think. These were Jewish believers. It was a synagogue. And Paul's practice was to go to synagogues when he went to a new place, because he had a contact, so he went. And these Bereans lived in a pagan world, a Greco-Roman world, surrounded by paganism, by idolatry, and all that went with it. They were a small group, minority group, trying to live their lives as faithful Jews, in the midst of what is a very hostile society. But they were a people who were open-minded. We see that here, because when Paul and Silas went there, what happened? They were welcomed. Different from Thessalonica, where the mob drove them out, these guys were welcomed in. So Paul and Silas were there on the second missionary journey, preaching the gospel. And they went to this synagogue in Berea, and it says they were welcomed, basically. And the Bereans did three things that were very important. It says here that the Bereans proved themselves to be more noble. Now, whether that was to do with the fact that some of the women were of noble birth, of high position, or just noble-minded, it's open to interpretation. But notice what they did. They received the word. They received the word with eagerness. They didn't just let it come to them and accept it as any old thing. They received it. There were Greeks who loved to debate. There were Jews who loved to debate. And they wanted to know what was true. And that's a lesson for us when we're sitting here in the sermon this morning or any other day, any other Sunday. We want to know what's true, don't we? We want to know that what is being said is actually the word of God. So that's the first thing. They received the word, they listened to it. But they did more than that. It says they examined. And if anybody's done accountancy work or done legal documents, then that's the sort of word that's being used here. They looked at it with a forensic mindset to see what was true. They weren't lazy. They didn't just take what was said as gospel, we would say. They wanted to know, and they searched the scriptures. Which scriptures? The Old Testament. They looked to the Old Testament to see what was true. They examined it. They didn't take Paul or Silas's word for it. We don't take preachers' words, whoever it is, when they're preaching, just as gospel themselves. It is the gospel we're looking at. It's the word of God. We have to take it. And so here, you see, they received it. They examined it. They got out their Bibles and they said, is this true? Is this faithful to that word of God? And then the third thing we notice, they believed it. They didn't just hear it, debate it, then go out and say, oh, that's interesting, wasn't it? Oh, I think I'll go and have fish and chips now. No. They believed what they heard. It says, many of them, therefore, believed. Not a few Greek women of high standing, as well as men. The gospel had effect. It changed lives. It changed the people who heard it. So they heard the word, they examined the word, they believed the word. And we find that reflected in Romans where it says, how then shall they call on him who they have not believed? And how are they to believe in him whom they have not heard? And how are they to hear without someone preaching? And how are they to preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful on the feet of those who preach the good news. They heard the word, they examined the word, and they believed the word. There's one other thing we need to remember. As we sit here this morning and we hear the word, and we believe the word is about our eternal Father, God, whom we know through Jesus Christ. It's not a matter of simple intellect, information. We sit here hearing the word of God so that we may know God, that we may know the living God. It's a great encouragement to us. Consider it. As we sit here this morning and hear the word of God, as Tony preaches, we are hearing God speak to us. The very God of creation, the very God of the universe, the very God who holds all things together by the power of his word, is speaking to us through his word. John says this, and this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, through Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. It's not knowing about God, it's knowing God. And there is a world of difference. And that world of difference makes the world of difference to us. Let's pray. Lord.